If you've already got ants in your pants after a few days in isolation, it may be some comfort to consider the morbid alternative. Researchers at Auckland University say that without intervention or preventative measures, as many as 80,000 New Zealanders could have died from COVID-19. But what impact has a full lockdown had on those projections? Auckland University's Professor Shaun Hendy is with us this morning. Tēnā koe, Shaun.
Morena, Jack.
83 cases confirmed yesterday, so that's two fewer than on Friday. Can we read anything into that?
I wouldn't want to read too much into it. I mean, what we're seeing at the moment, and this was expected, is we're seeing a lot of cases that are still related to international travel. And of course, those travel restrictions, they were tightened 2 weeks ago. And so we're expecting to see, you know, those cases related to international travel start to drop, especially this week. So they'll start to fall out of those statistics. And we do expect a drop or a plateauing in numbers. What we're really concerned about, and you know, what we're watching as modellers, is what about those clusters of community transmission? Those are the ones that have the potential for the exponential growth that we're seeing overseas.
And what does the data tell you about the capacity for that exponential growth? How bad could things be?
I mean, it could get very bad. I mean, the 80,000 figure, that was kind of the worst case scenario that we were looking at. You know, we're not facing that now that we've taken these steps, but we still have to be, you know, still a possibility that we could have tens of thousands of deaths. But given the steps that the government's taking, given the lockdown that they're taking, you know, that's reducing the possibility of that happening all the time.
How much is it reducing that possibility?
One of the things it does when we go into lockdown like this, I mean, basically the way it works in our models is, you know, there's a number called R0, and that's, you know, if you get infected, on average, how many other people will you infect? And by going into lockdown, you know, us keeping to our bubbles, we're protecting ourselves by not having contact with other people who might be infected. But also, if we do get infected, then we're reducing the number of people we might go on to infect. And that number, we want that number to get below one. So on average, right, every person is infecting less than one other person. And if we get that, then what we will see, you know, we'll actually contain and be able to eliminate the disease in New Zealand. So that's the number we're looking for.
Now, I'll make it clear so you don't have to. You are not an epidemiologist or a virologist here. You are looking at the data. But from the data sets you have available to you and the current state of the New Zealand response, how many deaths are likely in New Zealand?
It's still really up in the air. I mean, one of the things that we've got, you know, it's a new disease. So, and, you know, we are working with people who are clinicians, who are epidemiologists, and they're working really hard to understand the international literature. You know, what is the information we're getting from overseas that tells us, that, you know, the characteristics of this disease? So we're kind of learning as we go about that. And then also, you know, how are New Zealanders responding to the lockdown? You know, are we actually staying at home? And it looks pretty good in Grey Lynn. People seem to be following the physical distancing here where I live. But we'll have to get a sense of how that's going in the country. So the scenarios are still really broad. I mean, it could just be a handful of deaths. You know, we've got several hundred cases now in New Zealand. We know from what we've seen overseas that means there will likely be some deaths as a result of that. And so if our tracking, if our tracing and testing regimes are strong enough, then actually that will really restrict those numbers. If not, then these lockdown measures will have to go on longer. We're still facing a scenario where we might have thousands of deaths. But we've got some control over that by how long these lockdowns last.
Is the Ministry of Health doing enough testing to give you the data you need?
We're just getting that starting to come through now. So that's really going to be our number one thing we're going to be working on this week, is to start incorporating that into the modelling. And we should be able to say something about how effective our testing and our contact tracing is sometime this week.
Just to be clear, though, is that a delay in the communication of the data points from the Ministry of Health to your team, or is it that the Ministry of Health isn't doing enough community testing yet?
It's actually the disease itself, really, because the there's a lag, right? There's an incubation period that's actually quite variable for different people. Mm. And so actually we've sort of, you know, we've got to look at that data, and everybody has to remember that the numbers that are being announced every day, right, some of those people were infected up to 2 weeks ago. Mm. And so there's this lag effect that just means that from a statistical point of view, we have to wait for a certain amount of time before we can really understand what the disease is doing in New Zealand.
I appreciate these are early days, but from the data you have at the moment, do you think we'll be coming out of lockdown in 4 weeks?
I wouldn't want to make a call at this stage. I think it does really depend on how well we're sticking to things. I mean, people should prepare themselves for a longer lockdown. I mean, it's certainly a possibility that we might have to have longer lockdowns. I think the other thing is that we're considering whether we might be able to maintain regional lockdowns. So that's something that people should think about as well, the possibility that some parts of the country may come off level four earlier than other parts of the country, in particular if we're able to contain and keep the disease out of certain towns, certain regions, then they may be able to lift their levels earlier.
And this would be a response to the clusters that you referenced.
That's right. So if we can keep clusters out of, you know, parts of South Island, for example, or parts of the North Island, then maybe we can ease restrictions in those regions. I mean, you still would have to have controls on whether people can come in and out of those regions. So there'll still be restrictions, but it may be you can go, say, from level four to level three a little bit earlier than other parts of the country.
Is this our future until we get a vaccine? Is that what the modelling tells you at this stage?
Yeah, look, even if the next 4 weeks goes to plan, you know, and I think we've got a good plan in place, even if that goes to plan, you know, the reality is it's got out of control overseas, you know, and that wasn't within our ability to influence as a small country. Other countries have let it get out of control, and that makes it quite dangerous for us, even if we can keep ourselves safe here and eliminate it here in the next 4 weeks. So people should anticipate, you know, international travel restrictions for quite some time until we have that vaccine, right, which would then protect us if we were to go traveling overseas, or allow people to potentially come here if they've been vaccinated, or potentially antibody tests, right? So there are a number of antibody tests that could actually, the blood tests that can check whether you've been exposed to the disease and whether you have immunity. And so if those kind of testing regimes become widely available, that might allow us to ease some of those international travel restrictions. But we have to do what we can to keep it out, you know, once we've eliminated it within New Zealand.
Professor Shaun Hendy from Auckland University, it is always so good to speak. Thank you very much for your time.
Good to talk to you too, Jim.